This week's podcast is sponsored by MusicCast Wireless Surround, brought to you by Yamaha. Music is meant to be shared, and MusicCast provides easy access to your entire home entertainment library from anywhere in your home. Whatever you need, MusicCast can lift your home entertainment experience to a whole new level. Find out more at uk.yamaha.com. Hello and welcome to the Aviforms podcast for sometime on Monday the 4th of March. And joining me in this edition, Steve Withers.
I do not travel with peasants and beggars.
And Ed Silly.
I'd wish for a puppy.
And welcome back to the podcast. I've just been shooting some videos and I'm sitting here with pyjama bottoms on and a nice dress shirt.
Cool.
What?
I figured you only being shot up from the waist up.
Then. I was only being shot from the waist up, yeah.
So oh, right, fair enough.
What I did was I stacked up all the AVR boxes that I've got at the minute. So the product was at chest height. It's a projector. And I stood behind the boxes with just a shirt. So I might be short on what I'm saying tonight because I've talked for quite a bit already because there was lots of outtakes. It's the first one I've done to camera for some time.
So is it long then, is it?
It won't be.
Were there a lot of mistakes?
I've probably got enough to do the whole Christmas outtakes video in just that one afternoon of trying to get that done. But anyway, that's what I've been doing. And the rest of the week has just flown by as normal. I can't think of anything interesting I've done other than work. What about you, Ed?
It's been very similar for me. I hope you noticed that only 2 days late in a 28-day month, everything went up on the site yesterday, and it's been uploaded and all the rest of it. So I'm now, in terms of bit, from a point where I was a week behind at the start of 2019, I've hauled it back to 2 days. So we might be actually evens to finish on March 31st with my March stuff.
Yeah,
one step at a time, obviously. Otherwise, no. What have I done? It's been work or work related. I mean, I went to Sutton Coldfield on Tuesday, right. But that was for I had to visit another hi-fi dealer piece for a magazine. I don't understand driving in Birmingham. It's like a massive sort of Freemason society. Essentially, if you know what you're doing. I'm sure it all makes perfect sense, but it would appear that the only way to actually work out what's happened is to actually go through a junction and see where you're headed after you've done it. It's not very user-friendly, but that's by the by. Otherwise, no, it's fine. I made a cracking fish pie last night. I will say that. That was unexpectedly successful.
Did you make it?
Yeah.
All right. Did you actually go and catch the fish?
Yeah, I caught all the fish and smoked the haddock. Yeah, the whole works. No, it was quite successful. But I first time I've used whole soft boiled eggs in there as well, which are quite luxuriant when they pop in the mix. So I obviously MasterChef is casting a long shadow activities.
Is it like your normal cooking? I say your normal cooking. I've only ever been fed once with you, Ed, but it was enough to feed an army.
Well, look, it's a big lad. Yeah. But it's going to be eaten over a couple of days. Hold on a second. I did take a picture of it.
I'm trying to think where Ed last cooked for us. Are you talking about when you made that pasta in America?
Yeah, the one where we were both so stuffed with the cold that we couldn't taste any of it.
Oh, yeah. You must have. Yeah. You couldn't have literally given me anything at that point. Like, I couldn't taste a thing.
Yeah.
Well, I'll bear that in mind. I should have just fed you styrofoam, but no.
Might as well.
I thought you did.
I'll let you go. But no, I was quite pleased with that. I felt that it went pretty well. So okay. I've got more of that this evening. So after this, provided I can still stand, I will have some more of that, probably with buttered samphire as well alongside.
Okay, you're going to have to add a picture to the thread just so this is we've got some context here for people who are listening in. Okay, so interesting. So, Steve, what have you been up to then?
I think the same as you guys, really. I haven't done anything particularly interesting this week. I've just mostly been working and watching Game of Thrones a lot.
Right. How long
have you got? I'll be done well before the 14th of April. I'm already on season 3, so no problem. But I tell you what, it's absolutely brilliant.
Did you go and buy them all again in Atmos, or did you just buy the later ones?
Over the last few years, I've been rebuying. I got them all in. I've got the Atmos steelbooks, so they all fit together really nicely. It's actually quite a nice package.
And isn't Atmos steelbook one of the characters? characters in Game of Thrones.
A few of the characters. No, it looks awesome on the projector. It's so cinematic. The production values are, you know, cinema quality. So it looks spectacular. It sounds great with the Atmos mixes, and it's just a brilliant bit of TV. The quality, you know, the writing is so good. Some of the lines are hysterical. It's a beautiful piece of TV, and you know I cannot wait for the last season. So I'll be ready to go by the 14th of April. But that's basically what I've done. That and review a boatload of subwoofers, which is killing my back at the moment.
Right. At least you're getting a workout. It's that is.
Yeah, well, that is true. That's exactly how I
yeah, but it's standard hi-fi reviewer workout. There's no actual aerobic to it. It's just deadlift.
Yep. Yeah, and it's move around. On the what is it, the styrofoam, you move it around until it slots in, because you can't lift it up, you just squash it in.
I wish they'd think about where you're going to put your fingers, because some manufacturers, there's little gaps so you can get your fingers in underneath the sub and lift it up. It's just wedged in at the bottom there, and you can't get it out for love or money. And the only way you can get it out is by putting the box on its side and then carefully turning it until it's upside down and it falls out.
It must have said, as ever, honourable mention to SVS for decent subwoofer unboxing.
That's who I'm thinking of. They've got little handholds in there for your hand. Yeah. The other three, not so much.
I think we should start up a YouTube channel of pack and unpack hi-fi gear, and we'll just all have GoPros just set up at the side, and you just set them away in time lapse every time you get something in. That'd be hilarious watching that.
Reboxing some of the turntables, you'd need to do that in sped up.
That's what Phil meant.
That's what I meant by time lapse. Yeah.
But the Trium's already doing its good work.
Chris, we're only 7 minutes in? My God. Right, okay. I guess that kind of wraps up everything we're doing. We're going to be talking quite a bit about the hardware we have been looking at. But before that, we've got current competitions. Ed, before you get too drunk, why don't you tell us what we can win?
Right. You can win a Yamaha MusicCast 50 speaker worth £399. It closes on the 11th of March. You can win a Paramission QX2 bookshelf speakers in Rosewood worth £399. It closes on the 12th of March. You can win a copy of Schindler's List on 4K Blu-ray, which closes on the 6th of March. Win a copy of Redcon 1 on Blu-ray. I don't know what that is. You can win that on... Okay, well, go all out to win that one. Closes on the 11th of March. Win a copy of Vestron's Collector's Series on Blu-ray. You're making this up. Class of 1999.
Well, I've heard of that film.
Parents and the Unholy. Is that lots of different things, or is that the longest title of something ever?
No, that's three films.
It closes on the 14th of March. And then you can win a copy of Halloween on Blu-ray, which closes on the 11th of March. Now, all these competitions are open to eligible AV Forums members resident in the UK, except Phil. And if you're on the Isle of Man, I don't know about that either. But, you know, you'll live with that. And before you ask, we have a previous competition winner. And it's someone I'd quite like to speak to. Because Big Al 217, he won the GT Omega gaming chair. And if he can fill us in on whether he's attached a 6-point harness or anything like that to it, that would be brilliant. I'd like to know how he's getting on with the gaming chair and what it's like. Because it was a source of mild fascination to us whilst it was a prize. And only he has the answers, because he's got one.
There you go. So if you want to get in touch with Ed, we'll leave it up to you, Big Al 217. You can tell him all about it. Or not, up to you. Okay, that's the first section done. There's an ident coming, and we're going to do hardware news. Okay, hardware news. We got three reviews this week, which is quite unusual for everybody to have reviews. But we'll do that, and then we'll go over what we're going to be doing for the rest of the month as well, seeing as it's beginning of a new month. It is March already. So this week I have been mostly reviewing the Optoma UHL55 projector. So it's a 4K DLP. Once again, it's not a home cinema projector, But actually, I quite like what Optoma or Optima, depends how you want to say it. I really like.
Do they have a way of pronouncing it? Is there? I always said Optoma. I don't know.
I've always said Optoma, but then I've had a few people saying Optima recently, and including an employee of the company. So
that's a clue then, isn't it?
Yeah, usually.
It's like Emotiva or Emotiva. I'm never quite sure which one.
Yeah,
I am.
Yeah. So anyway, this
NAD
is a
NAD.
This is a 4K DLP, but it's not like these the host of, you know, the big vast numbers of them we've had through recently from BenQ and so on. This is not based on an office projector chassis or anything like this. This has got its own chassis, and it looks a bit like an old-fashioned Nintendo gaming system. It's a square box, and the way that they've done it is they've designed it into like a double-decker design. So the projector's on the top, and you've got the speakers on the bottom. So, as you can guess, it's designed as a home entertainment projector, not a home cinema projector, but it's only £1,500, and I thought, well, it's worth having a look at this, because it looks quite interesting, because, as we've noticed over the last few months, people are downsizing in all areas of their hobby at the moment, and this kind of fits a little niche that a lot of manufacturers have been aiming their standard machines at, which is the portable, use at your mate's house, watch the big football game on it or sporting event on it, watch a 3D movie game on it, that kind of thing. This one's got the sound built in, so you could take the whole thing with you and plonk it down. It's only, I think it's 7 watts per channel, so it's not that loud, and I've got to say it sounds quite tinny actually when you got it turned up.
Yeah,
but then
use it personally.
No, I wouldn't use it either. But if you want something that's you know, portable and you want to use it for a sporting event, maybe in the office or whatever when the boss is out, you know, during the World Cup or whatever, it would do for that. You know, it would do for a football commentary, or you didn't have a sound system around, at least you got speakers built in there, and they're decent speakers compared to what's in other projectors. It's just they're still not hell of a loud that great. So it's using the 4K chip from Texas Instruments, the one that does the 4 flashes, so you do have a grey border around it. In terms of the lens, it's a fixed lens, so there's no zoom on this, so you have to place the projector far enough back to get the size image you want. You want 100 inches, it's around about 9 feet back from the screen or the wall to get 100 inch diagonal 16:9 image. It does have a really clever autofocus. And I thought, well, how does it do that? And it uses a little laser, and it's absolutely spot on. It gets the focus. You just set it down.
That's handy.
And it just sets a focus for you straight away. And
it's like, thing that high-end projectors would actually genuinely benefit from, but
yeah,
they won't do it because
it's
easy.
Bloody hard to focus a 4K projector when you can't see the bloody pixels.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
If it did it automatically, that would be brilliant.
Yeah, so, I mean, the autofocus, it works great for this, and it's a DLP, so it's sharp anyway, you know, it's not a 3-panel or whatever, it's just one chip, you know. So that looks good. It's also got the auto keystone, but you can switch that off, which I did straight away. Do not keystone any projected image. Set the projector up correctly so you don't need it. Otherwise, you start introducing all sorts of nasties into your image. And again, it's an LED light source, so it's not a bulb. It's actually an LED, and I've got to say, instant on, instant off. It's great. You've got
quite cool, isn't it?
You've got a little slider for the lens cover. So again, a lot of mega projectors like Steve's £8,000 N7 hasn't got a lens cover, a slidable lens cover, has it? Yeah, this is
no, it has not. It comes with a crappy, really hard plastic thing that I don't even use because I don't want to get it put anywhere near my lens.
Yeah, so this comes with a little slidable thing. You've got to use your finger to slide it, but as soon as you slide it open, the projector switches on, and it's almost instant when it switches on, which is, you know, the beauty of laser light and LED light source that this has. 30,000 hours claimed. It's not very bright, though. And you've had a few LED projectors, haven't you, in the past?
That was going to be my first question.
Yeah, yeah,
how
yeah.
bright
it's,
is it?
It's not that bright. I mean, yeah. If you're looking for...
They're not bright.
If you're looking for a bright projector, go for a bulb-based machine. If you want something that you're going to be able to use in a light-controlled room, and you have to use this in a light-controlled room, you can use it with white walls and white ceilings.
It doesn't sound like
that's
what it's aimed at, though.
Well, you can still use it in a normal living room, but you're going to have to close the curtains. You're going to have to put the ambient lights off if you want the best of the image quality, because it is a little bit dimmer than competing models where that are using a bulb. But then again, you don't have to change the bulb over. You don't have to worry about the bulb blowing up. And when you've got something that's portable, I think that's more important. If it's going to get a knock now and again, if you see if a bulb's still cooling down and it gets a knock, you could be in trouble.
Thermal
there.
Shock is not your friend under those circumstances.
So at least with LED, you give it enough time to cool down, and it doesn't need as long as a bulb to cool down, you should be fine. You should be not an incident. So there's a few little things here and there, that little quirks and so on. But it, like I say, I mean, it's designed for a certain market. And the clever thing is that it has a media player built in. It also has apps built in. So it has Android TV on board. So this is Android TV that you get in budget TVs, not the Android TV that you get in the Sony's and the Philips.
Yeah, I've seen a little sort of one of those little Pico projectors not so long ago. And that had its own menu system, you know, homepage, Android-based platform. And you could actually access things like Netflix in the projector, which is kind of quite a cool little feature. Yeah.
So you can do all that with this as well. It's got AI, so it works with Alexa voice control. My God, did that take forever to set that up?
Was it like that?
I was going to say,
like that good thing on that one that blows two comedians in the lift.
Oh, it was almost like that. Yeah, it took so long to get it to pair up and do this and do that, and so it would work. And then the things you can do is switch on, switch it off.
Yeah, you got to know. If you don't know the correct commands, it doesn't work anyway. So
yeah.
99 times out of 100, it is quicker and easier just to grab the remote.
Yeah. But it does that, and it was nice of Optima to send me the an Echo Dot, because I don't have
that's handy,
So that was handy. They sent that in the box, and they also sent 3D glasses, which manufacturers never do that these days. And they were brand new. They were still in the wrapping. They hadn't been taken out of the wrapping. They're absolutely brand new. So I'm going to go to 3D first, because I think that is the strong point of this projector. If you're still into 3D, you want a portable projector and so on, this is fantastic, because it's DLP as well. No crosstalk whatsoever. And because you're putting the glasses on, and the glasses have a certain tint to them, black levels are decent as well. So the black levels with HD and 4K material are what you would expect for this level of machine at this price point. They're grey. They're a dark grey. Actually, they're a dark reddish grey, because it's too much red in the image, unfortunately. You've got to dial that out. But in terms of the 3D side of things, stonking. I sat down to watch a couple of scenes from Titanic. I've got the 3D disc. It's a post-conversion, but it's really well done. I think we've discussed it a couple of weeks ago.
It's one of the best conversions, actually.
So I sat down to watch a couple of scenes, ended up watching the whole disc, because it's split over two discs or three discs. I can't remember exactly what, but it was...
Watched all 3 hours of it?
No. I just watched one disc.
Watched the first disc.
Yeah, because it's split over so many discs. So I sat and watched one anyway, because it was so good. I mean, the 3D was really, really good on this, and it was bright enough as well, because obviously I'm testing it in a complete bat cave, so it was bright enough to sit and watch that, and thoroughly enjoyed it. And it's a really nice experience. The motion was nice. It comes with the Pure Motion frame interpolation switched on. You just got to go in the menu and switch that off. But 3D wise, absolutely brilliant. In terms of film material, like I say, there was too much red in the image, especially in the lower end of the image. Gamma was all over the place. I couldn't do anything with gamma, even trying to calibrate it. It had an S-curve where it was clipping the blacks, and it had too much red in the blacks as well. So the only way of getting the red out of the blacks was to go into the tint control and move that to take the reds out of there, which was a bit unfortunate that it was like that out of the box. But like four or five clicks, and I managed to get it looking quite nice. In terms of calibration, there was white balance control in there, so I was able to get the grayscale a little bit better. I couldn't do much with the gamma, because it had different options, but they were all just more or less the same S-curve, just slightly varied. 90 IRE, it was so bright it wouldn't register on the charts. So, yeah, gamma was a bit over the place, which did affect image quality. But I've got to say, at this price point, what the projector's aimed at, I watched The Greatest Showman, I watched Blade Runner, a couple of other discs that I use, Pan and so on, sat and give it some good time to go through, because one of the main things with these DLP projectors is banding, is posterization, because they're 8-bit machines. They have struggled in the past. The Optoma didn't. I didn't get any banding or any posterization, especially in the Blade Runner scenes, you know, the New Vegas scenes and so on, which is a great scene to test for posterization. There wasn't any in there, so the picture processing was actually really quite nice. It wasn't doing anything naughty in there. It looked a little bit too sharp at times. There was a little bit of noise reduction going on in the background as well, which you can't switch off. But again, looking at the price point, looking at the market, I don't think that's an issue. It cleans the image up, so it looks a bit sharper, and people are going to like that. Whether it's technically correct or not, I don't think you can point the finger at a product at this price point. So overall, I've got to say, for what it does and the price at £1,500, it's got decent speakers built in for something like this. It's built like a portable projector should be. It's nice that Optoma have taken some time to think about the logistics, to think about ergonomics, what people are actually going to do with it. Have a lens cover, even though it's a manual lens cover, but have a lens cover so the lens doesn't get scratched or whatever, if it's in a bag or being moved around or put away in storage or whatever. So, and the image quality is decent for what it is. It'll take a 4K HDR signal. You're not getting an HDR picture at this price point. The Gamma does do a little bit of different curve for HDR, but it's not much. I mean, the measurements, I'm not even going to put the measurements into the review video because it didn't even hit 65 nits in terms of the measurements. And you could see how it was mapping, so it was a little bit different. But yeah, it's not a hell of a bright projector. That's the only thing going against it. So you do need to close the curtains if you're using it in a normal living room and switch any lights off to get the best out of it. But yeah, it's not a badge winner. But for what it does and the price
What was the price?
£1,500.
Right. Yeah, that's pretty cheap, actually.
Yeah, it's not.
I mean, you see, I was sort of from a disinterest from a non-committed perspective. I was listening to this and thinking, oh, it sounds like it does quite a lot. And £1,500 isn't discretionary spending. It's one of those things. If it had, if they'd monstered every margin going and turned it out for like 999, you could sort of see where it was going. But that's still quite a lot of money. I mean, yeah, I appreciate it does a lot, but I would be interested to know how much they could have saved by getting rid of the 7-watt amp and the speakers.
There is that, but then it's got frame interpolation, which you don't get with a lot of the competition at that price point.
even if you did turn it off,
even if you are turning it off, but. People will like frame interpolation, especially if you're going to watch sports and that kind
football,
of thing.
Football, that sort of stuff. Yeah,
so, that's handy. In terms of input lag, it was 66 milliseconds, which is...
A bit high.
It's a bit high, but then think about who it is. It's console gaming, and that's who it's aimed at, and it's teenagers, that sort of...
Just have four cans of Stella, and your input lag will be lower
is, you're not going to have... competitive gamers there. They're not going to be playing to that kind of standard. So again, it fits the bill. You can use it as a Bluetooth speaker as well if you really wanted to. but the functionality is there. It's wireless. Yeah. It's got Wi-Fi. It's got the built-in media player. And it's got the built-in apps. It does Netflix from the box. So actually, it's got a lot of things that far more expensive projectors don't have. So again, It's aimed at a certain market, and if that appeals to you, then it is one to go and look at and demo because it's purpose built for that reason. It's not a repurposed office projector like some of the competition are. So yeah,
I suppose I ought to get off my high. I mean, complaining about that costing £1,500, and next to me on the table there's a pair of £1,800 earphones. So
yeah. And the other beauty is LED light source, 30,000 hours. You're never going to be changing bulbs or anything like that, which is good. So you're saving money there.
No, come the apocalypse, provided that you've got a means of powering it, you will continue to have the means of broadcasting stories from the long, long ago and things like that. So
it's a shame it's not a bit brighter because you could use it as an alternative to a TV, couldn't you, with that kind of lifespan?
You could, but again,
you'd need to sit in a perennially darkened room.
Maybe not. I mean, this is you're not going to have a proper screen with this, I don't think. You're going to point it at a white wall. And that's how they're advertised it. The advert that goes with it, the video I found on YouTube for this projector, is a couple sitting down to their evening meal with it pointed at a white wall, watching the news, which seemed like an odd way to...
That's what I use a projector for.
It seemed like an odd way to promote it, but there you go. So that's what I've been looking at. And the video, I've been working on the video tonight, so the video should be out in the next week.
Skills.
Right, so moving on to Steve, you've been looking at a soundbar.
I have. And it's a bit of a game of two halves here because it's the Wharfdale Vista 200S. So Wharfdale released the Vista 200 earlier last year. That was just a soundbar. The Vista 200S is exactly the same soundbar, but this comes with a subwoofer, with an active wireless subwoofer, so hence the suffix, the S suffix. Got it, set it up, attractively designed soundbar, nicely made. Glossy black top, which I could have done without because it reflected the TV screen a bit. But other than that, I mean, I couldn't complain about the build quality of the design. It was attractive looking. It's got a recess at the back for the connections. It includes an HDMI connection, so you can connect to the ARC channel on the TV and you can send audio back to the soundbar from the TV via ARC. So excellent. Also had optical and coaxial digital inputs. Also got Bluetooth built in and a 3.5mm analog jack as well. So pretty much everything covered there. Well, that's good. Set it up. The soundbar and the subwoofer compared automatically. Great. Got watching some stuff on it. You know, now it's basically a 2.1 system, and it sounded really good. I thought, well, this sounds really nice with TV programs like MasterChef. Sounded really good. Put on the movie. It's got some bass in there. Nice wide front soundstage. Excellent, excellent. Sounds good. Put some music on through my iPhone and Bluetooth. That sounded really nice as well. I thought, well, this is a solid, well-made soundbar. And then I looked at the price. £219. And I thought, sodding hell, I don't think I can find another soundbar and active wireless subwoofer combo for that price.
Sorry, it's
£219 you can get it for. And I did look. I looked hard because I thought, well, I need to find some alternatives for the review. And the only alternative I could find was the the Acoustic Energy iGo soundbar, which I reviewed a couple of years ago. That's a little bit smaller, so it's a smaller soundbar. It's a good sounding soundbar, but it's a little bit smaller. It's aimed at smaller TVs. You could use the Wharfdale I did use it with a 65-inch screen, and you could use it up to that size, no problem at all. The iGo is a little bit smaller than that, and it comes with a subwoofer, but it's wired and it doesn't have an HDMI connection. So, and it's exactly the same price, £219. So for a soundbar and subwoofer combo with an active wireless subwoofer and an HDMI connection, and it sounds good for £219, that's an absolute bargain.
That is ridiculous. Yeah, I mean, it must have said they've got form for this, though, because I did that little pack of 5.1 speakers. And yeah, again, it was like looking around for the competition. It's like anything that it competes against at that price point is a little plastic box, and they aren't little plastic boxes. No. I mean, it must be said they've got some proper production clout behind them, and when they feel like it, they can just turn stuff out that everyone else is going, how on earth do you do that? So yeah, I was listening to your description again. This is the reverse Optima. I was listening to your description. Yeah, it seems perfectly reasonable, but that is discretionary spending. That's the sort of thing where even if you weren't using it in the front room, you could bolster a secondary television somewhere else with it.
Absolutely, you could. Yeah. I mean, it basically, if you've got a TV and you're thinking, that sounds very good, I want to beef up the sound, really upgrade it, this is a great way of doing it.
Well, another way,
dead easy to set up, job done.
Another way of thinking of it is all these Bluetooth and wireless speakers that you get nowadays. You could use it for that if you really wanted to, and use it as a soundbar. It
fulfills
both things, doesn't it?
Yeah, because
it's a stereo soundbar, basically. It sounds great with music. When I first got it out, I was moaning, thinking like, oh, it's a bit low on the features, isn't it? And I hadn't seen the price at this point, and I'm thinking how they delivered it. Yes, it doesn't have multi-channel. Yes, it doesn't have multi-room, but, let's be honest, you're not going to use most of that anyway.
But they've got form for this, because it reminds me when I did the Mission LX2. Which I was doing in a split-arsing hurry at the same time as lots of other things. And I sort of was resigned to writing the review going, well, it's not the prettiest thing to look at, but it's the best it's the best £400 speaker I've heard in a couple of years. Realised they were £160. right, okay, well, let's alter the tone of this review ever so slightly then, shall we? So, when in doubt, IAG can really, really pull it out the bag.
If anyone listening to this podcast is looking for a soundbar sub £250, take a look at the Wharfdale Vista 200S, because
put us on pause, go and order one and come back. Yeah, basically
you're not going to find better for less. It's as simple as that.
I take it it's getting a Best Buy badge.
Yes. Originally, I was going recommended badge. I think, this is worth a recommend. It's good. And then I saw the price. Right, I'm going to have to rewrite a lot of this. Yes, it's Yes, it's definitely a Best Buy. No question about it.
Okay. You've been looking at another product, not for us, but it's interesting enough to talk about on the podcast because, I mean, hopefully we'll be getting it in for a review here soon. No, that's the new Samsung TV, the Q90. So just
Q90R,
yeah, to be precise. Just very quickly, Steve, I mean, obviously it's a pre-production. I know you had a couple of niggles with it, but overall?
Overall, I was very, very impressed. I know I had seen a pre-production version back in November. You saw a pre-production, I believe, at CES. I had a rough idea what to expect, and we talked about it on the podcast a few weeks ago when we were talking about the how they've got this these two layers to focus the light so that you get a much wider viewing angle.
Yeah,
and I've got to say it works. It really genuinely works. You can walk from one side of the room to the other and there's no discernible difference in terms of, normally with a VA panel, as soon as you start moving off axis you just drop off a cliff in terms of contrast and color. It does not do that in the same way that an OLED does not do that, and I didn't think I'd ever see an LCD do that, to be perfectly honest. I was gobsmacked. And it does it without, unlike the Sony, it does it without sacrificing other areas of performance. So it's still got really good blacks. It's still, it is a VA panel. It's got local dimming. It's a direct LED backlight. I think the number of zones are exactly the same as last year's Q9 FN, so just under 500. But it's not just the number of zones. It's also how the local dimming is applied to those zones. It's an improved local dimming system, so it's not as much. It's not quite as aggressive at just above black as it was last year. Honestly, I had got a friend to come round because I wanted to see what he'd think, and I didn't tell him what it was. He thought it was an OLED until I told him it was an LCD television. So it looks like an OLED, only obviously it's a lot brighter. So when you get, obviously when I'm talking about SDR, I'm setting it to 120 nits, so that would be identical to an OLED in terms of brightness. But when you move on to HDR, of course, it goes up to 1600 nits, and suddenly, and it was 100% of DCI P3. So the HDR performance was absolutely superb. Hmm. And I've got to say, I was really genuinely, I thought, blimey, this, because I was kind of thinking that Samsung are sort of just treading water, waiting for microLED to come along. But they're not. They're still, doing things with LCD that I didn't think would ever happen. And this TV really, without question in my mind, is the best LCD television I've ever seen.
Yeah, but then again, for context, you said that last year.
That was the best one I've seen last year. It's better than last year.
Yeah, okay. I've got to say, the Q9 FN, I've had that here for a while now. It's improved with firmware throughout the year. When there's been an update, it has improved. When I saw the Q900R, which is the 8K screen just before Christmas here, I was really quite impressed. I really was, because I had my doubts about, the local dimming algorithms being aggressive. And there was a couple of issues with it, which they sorted with firmware. But they had listened and they'd taken the feedback and worked on it. And I've got to say, for what I've seen there and what I saw at CES, it is impressive what they can do with local dimming. It's not perfect, though.
Yeah, it's not. I mean, there are certain. I mean, I did try. I watched various things to catch it out. So and it handled things like gravity very well. I mean, as well as the OLED. I finally caught it out with the HDR disc, the 4K disc of First Man. There's a scene in First Man when they're first going into lunar orbit where they go into the shadow of the moon. And the screen goes completely black. And then gradually, the surface of the moon is visible through the window of the command module. Bastard of a scene to do with local dimming. And on the OLED, that black screen was completely black. And then you gradually saw the moon appear through the window in the middle of the frame. And it couldn't quite do that as well as the OLED could. So there's still areas where OLED's obviously being self-emissive has the edge. But 90% of the time, it was performing as well as the OLED. So, I think depending on what you're watching, I mean, yes, you can find content that's going to, going to trip you up a little bit compared to an OLED. But then there are other areas where it will be better than OLED because obviously it can go a lot brighter than the OLED can. But overall, I've got to say, I was gobsmacked actually, to be honest, at some of the performance levels it was delivering.
It's a glorious testament to bloody minded. That's true. In some ways, that's what makes it so magnificent. It's obstinately taking a technology that just on an underlying level can't do these things.
It should
have throwing enough money and engineers at the problem until it does. And I can't help but admire that. It's like, no, we're never going to buy these panels from our arch rival. And you can just imagine this group of weeping, sleepless men and women going, no, it can't be done. And then some authoritarian figure in a suit going, well, you don't have any choice. If you want to see your children again, you're going to make it happen. And they're just sort of, you know, just sort of, they sort of slump and then just go off and then they make it happen. And that's, in its own perverse way, that's magnificent. So it, that's almost not the message that Samsung wanted to get out with this television, but it's the message I take. So, yeah.
I mean, when plasma finally disappeared, I think that was, some of us saw that as a Concorde moment. Because we were kind of thinking, because remember when plasma disappeared, OLED wasn't cost effective and wasn't around like it is now. It was almost a Concorde moment. It was like,
yeah, we're pioneers were keeping their value, weren't they?
Yeah, we're taking a step backwards here, going with LCD going forward and so on. And from that point to where you are now, where you've got an LED set competing with, I'm not going to say bettering, but competing with an OLED screen. In where the OLED strengths are, that's impressive. That is impressive.
It is. It's got one. My major issue is nothing to do with the picture quality, and it was less of an issue last year. But this year, now that you've got Philips and Panasonic and possibly other manufacturers as well committing to both HDR 10 Plus and Dolby Vision, I think that both Samsung and, on the other side of the fence, LG, are going to suffer this year if they don't support both formats.
Yeah, absolutely.
People are going to tick boxes in the shop. They're going to say, does it do both? I don't want it, but it doesn't do that. And that's the problem they're going to face right now, because it supports HDR 10 Plus, but it does not support Dolby Vision.
Yeah.
And HDR 10 Plus works fine. I did test that out on the watching the Grand Tour. I think you saw this at CS. Now it has a little thing that says HDR 10 Plus on the quick menu, so you can actually tell it's receiving it. With the player, obviously, I could see what it was outputting, so I knew it was outputting HDR 10 Plus. Doesn't support Dolby Atmos in the sense that it hasn't got Dolby Atmos processing for the speakers, although it's got intelligent sound, which I got to say worked really well. So I'm not so fussed about that. And it can output Dolby Atmos by Dolby Digital Plus from apps to a Atmos soundbar, for example. That is something it can do. I think what was really interesting, this is something that I didn't... So the other thing I thought, because I was looking at where are the negatives, because, you know, look at the overall package, you've got, you know, no Dolby Vision, so that's definitely a negative. Atmos I'm not so concerned about, and it outputs Atmos if you need it back to over HDMI, ARC, back to a soundbar or receiver, so that's fine. The actual smart platform is fantastic. It's got absolutely every single video streaming service you can think of, and in a couple of months, it'll have iTunes as well. So as a smart platform, absolutely amazing. Fast, responsive, well laid out. I love the second layer idea. I think that's really clever. The whole thing works really well. So I thought, okay, good. And then I was thinking, what else is there that I can, you know, where else could it be where could it be a negative for the TV? And I thought, well, hasn't got HDMI 2.1. Now I know we've discussed this at length, and you're thinking you don't need it. But I thought people going into stores might say, you know, it hasn't got HDMI 2.1. So I had this word with Samsung, and I said, what can it actually do over HDMI 2.0b? And this is where they surprised me. This TV doesn't have HDMI 2.1, but it can accept 4K, 120 hertz, 10-bit, 420. It can do VRR. It can do auto game mode. And it can do it could do EARC. Doesn't at the moment, because frankly, there's no need for it. But if they needed to add it, they could. And obviously, you can do dynamic mesh data because you can do HDR 10 Plus. So actually, you don't need HDMI 2.1 at all.
This is what we've been saying, because, you know, you can go and buy an LG this year that's got HDMI 2.1, but are they going to switch the features on?
If they can do 4K 120 hertz over HDMI 2.0b, then you literally don't need 2.1. All you need it for is for 8K, which is obviously irrelevant on these TVs because they're not 8K panels. So, in fact, and I didn't realize you could do this, but there's always been so much confusion or grey area around HDMI 2.1 and what you can do with 2.0b. But according to Samsung, they can do 4K 120 hertz over 2.0b. So there's no need for it. So if you're worrying about not having 2.1, don't.
yeah. Exactly the argument we've been having for weeks. Because, like I say, it could have 2.1, but it's up to the manufacturers to make sure that those features are all switched on. So you could have a 2.1 TV, that has a 2.1 input, but they don't have VRR switched on. You know what I mean? So, yeah.
As it currently stands, the new Samsung TVs, like the Q90R, will do everything you would need it to do right now. And some things that you don't need it to do right now. And like I say, if at some point, because the thing about enhanced ARC is it can send lossless audio back via HDMI to a receiver. However, as far as I'm aware, and correct me if I'm wrong here, Phil, there is no streaming services or nothing using lossless that you would need to send back via. So it's not a feature you actually need. So basically, what it has got though is VRR, an auto game load, and a 14 millisecond input lag. So if you're a gamer, you'd be quids in on this.
Sounds really interesting, and I'm really looking forward to getting it in for review. Like I say, I've got a Q9 here, and it's gotten better the longer I've had it. And are you going to sell your C8 now and get a Samsung, Steve?
I don't know, might do. The thing is, like I said, I would like a TV that does both Dolby Vision and HDR10+.
Yeah.
And that's neither LG or Samsung at the moment. I think both those companies need to have a long, hard think about what they're going to do.
Yeah. So, in fact, you're going to go and buy a Panasonic this year, then?
Yeah.
Right.
They look bloody good, I've got to say.
Absolutely. Right. Anyway, we need to crack on because Ed needs to talk about a turntable without slurring his speech.
Before I lose the power of speech inside, yeah. I've been looking at the Riga Planar 8. Now, compared to all the relentless excitement at the bleeding edge of cutting edge technology, you might reasonably assume that a record player, it's like, we've seen one of those. They play an ancient format in an ancient and predictable way. Now, to be absolutely clear, the Planar 8 still drags a tiny piece of sharpened diamond through the grooves of a record, but it is genuinely a very interesting piece of technology. Which sounds ridiculous, talking about a century-old playback medium, but I don't want to go too much. A lot of this ground is covered in the review, and I don't want to repeat it ad nauseam here. But Riga is a bit different to a lot of other turntable manufacturers, both in the UK and abroad, because as far as they're concerned, just simply making things heavier, which, let's face it, is pretty much a tenet of the entire audio industry, does not automatically make it better. This is one of the cleverest and most determined sort of implementations of controlled use of mass that I've seen in any product in a very long time. Essentially, where the Planar 8 needs mass to function, so at the edges of the platter, at the bearing assembly and so on and so forth, it's present. Where it doesn't need to have mass, and ideally would have no presence at all, it has been carved back, it has been pared, it has been stripped all the way back to the point where there is just the bare minimum of record player there to stop it essentially folding in half. The result is an extraordinary looking product. In the copy, I in one of my more creative moments, as far as I'm concerned, this is firmly from the Aerial Atom school of design. If it doesn't need to be there, it really isn't. There's not a single piece of adornment or frippery on the whole thing. And this isn't something that Riga's suddenly thrust upon us going, we suddenly decided to do this. In the background, and it's a source of slight consternation, no journalist has ever really spent any time with one of these. Riga, as well as the turntables that you see on the website, Riga makes something called the Naiad, which is a £30,000 turntable built only to special order by two senior members of the engineering team. And it's unclear exactly how many of them have been sold, but essentially there is, if you order one, you won't get it immediately. There are enough people ordering this £30,000 record player not to be an instantaneous thing. The Planar 8 is the principles that have been developed for the Naiad in a productionized and slightly less rarefied form. There's less use of titanium and other rather more expensive materials, for example. But the end result of this is genuinely one of the most extraordinary record players I've tested in quite a long time, because it does things at a price which is almost sensible that I didn't really feel was possible, for much less than £4,000 or £5,000, and on occasions a bit more. It's also the perfect antidote. If you just assume, oh, it's a turntable, it's going to be this sort of warm, cuddly, mid-ranged emphasis sort of thing, it's absolutely not. In fact, if you go for it with the most expensive of the cartridge options, it's probably more aggressive tonally than most digital sources you can buy in 2019, and it will not flatter stuff which hasn't been recorded properly. But the flip side to this is if you do feed it with stuff which has been halfway decently mastered, it's just an outstanding piece of equipment. And trying to keep this in a semi sort of organized sense, we've now started using the best in class badges. I think it's a very good thing. I have awarded this a best in class because fundamentally this is the last sensible stop in analog replay. After this point, you have to start matching up your arms, your cartridges, and essentially building the deck from scratch to do what you want it to do. You can buy complete turntables, but fundamentally I think they're pretty much all at a disadvantage next to being able to actually assemble the whole thing yourself from manufacturers that support that sort of thing. This is the last outpost of sanity in the whole vinyl replay game, and it's a truly outstanding product. And more than that, for me, it delivers on almost every level, because I enjoy simply looking at it. I enjoy interacting with it. It doesn't take up a huge amount of space. It is easy to set up. It's easy to use. It no longer has a lid, which is a slight detractor, but Riga, bless them, supply a dust cover as standard included in the price, which sounds perfectly reasonable, but an enormous number of their rivals don't do these sort of things. And it's the sort of product where, if you aren't an upgrade lunatic, you could buy it, and because it's a record player and fundamentally the technology inherent in analog replay hasn't changed in donkey's years, this could be your last ever turntable. And what's more, you could buy it and be happy for the rest of your days. And I think that's something to really celebrate, because it's not a given with any aspect of our industry under normal circumstances. We you know, for both multi-channel and for two-channel, it's all very, very expensive, and there's always something slightly better. And don't get me wrong, for vinyl replay there are better turntables than this. Riga makes one, for goodness sake, two, for goodness sake, but it's at the last point where it can all turn up in one box, and it is competitive with anything that I could assemble new for the same price by picking and choosing my turntable and my arm and my cartridge and so on and so forth. And I think that makes it a very, very special product.
Okay, good stuff. Best in class, and you can't get better than that.
Just one last thing. I would also just like to say thank you. First of all, I was pleasantly surprised the Musical Fidelity M6400i review went up. And for starters, quite a lot of people have read it. A surprisingly large number of people have read it. I'm delighted by that. And thank you for the people that said in the comment section that they enjoyed reading it. It does mean a lot. It's I enjoyed writing it, and I enjoyed listening to it, and I think obviously that always reflects on the nature of how the copy comes out. I'm sure it's the same for you guys, but
makes
nonetheless, it was great fun to it wasn't necessarily brilliant fun to watch my electricity meter actually going down on a pound by pound basis as it was running, but nonetheless it was huge fun to listen to, and I think that's reflected in the copy. But I'm really glad that you enjoyed reading it. In the comments, if for whatever reason large amplifiers is something that you want to see more of, do let me know, and I'll contact my GP and make sure that my spine is up to the task of moving the damn things around. But I'm always responsive to what people want to see more of. So if this is the sort of thing that's blown your frock up, let us know and we'll get something squared away. I've also seen your comments from last podcast about sorting out playlists for streaming services. I'm on it. For the end of this month, there will be a playlist of things what have been blowing my frock up over the course of the month, and we'll try and make it as available on as many services as we can.
Okay, a lot of frocks there.
Yeah.
it does make a difference that when you say that, if you enjoy your product. Because
no question,
there is so many middle of the road products out there, and I mean, obviously I only have to write the review once. You freelance guys, like Steve last week, with four different write-ups.
No, three.
Three. All right, but still, three times you've got to come up with the same thing.
It's hard work, actually.
Yeah,
I mean, it's one of those things, And for the avoidance of doubt, because if someone would automatically ask, well, then, especially in my case, most things that I look at get awarded a badge. And for the most part, with AV forums, I do get to choose my review product. So I don't have, there's very few things that it's a by the numbers piece of copy anyway. But it's also important to take one step out of your personal feelings and examine just how good something is. And there's a lot of things that we look at across all the categories, and this will apply to you guys as well, where they're exceptionally good. They're just not necessarily where you envisage spending your own money on it. And I do think that that reflects occasionally in copy.
If a product's really bad, it's easy to write about because you've got some stuff to work on. If it's exceptionally good, then it's easy to, it's the in-between bit. That's the difficult bit. Absolutely. Right, so in that vein, what are we doing this month? So Ed, what are you going to do for us?
Right, just uploaded, so in the system and ready to be used, we've got the last of the name all-in-ones, the Unity Nova, which is a £4,200 all-in-one system. So we have to ask, what on earth is that doing that the already amazing name Unity Star isn't doing? There is a pair of headphones from Audio Technica, which I think are a first because they've been on sale for years as wired headphones, and Audio Technica has gone and converted them to Bluetooth, and the results for that are fascinating. So I hope actually you'll find that I really enjoyed writing that one. There's a tiny little DAC from Audio Lab, which is designed to give your headphone socketless phone a headphone socket. And last but not least, I've reviewed a pair of speakers from an American brand called Revel. And that was also much more interesting than I thought it was going to be.
I love Revels.
Do you?
Especially when you get the Maltesers.
I was about to say, you're the
just buy a bag of Maltesers.
There's a saucer-shaped ones that you can't actual sweet
chocolate.
Yeah, really nice
chocolates.
Yeah.
I thought for a second that you were going to be the first person I talked to that actually had an opinion on Revel loudspeakers.
No, I have heard Revels.
So have I. But most of the time you just hear it, it's like, well, they're a pair of Revel loudspeakers. It's the first time I've spent any time in an environment with which I'm familiar, with equipment that I'm familiar, that I spent any time with a pair of Revels, and it's been a very, very interesting experience indeed. So should be a reasonable review, I hope, as well.
Good stuff. We haven't decided what everything that Steve's doing this month. I can only see two.
Things I was meant to have done last month.
Right.
Welcome to my world.
To my own. Polk command bar, which it's been delayed getting hold of it, but I'm supposed to be getting that any day. And that's actually a soundbar with an Amazon Alexa literally built into it. So that looks interesting. And also, I was going to do the Q900, but given that I'm about to see the 82-inch Q950R, which is the new 8K Samsung TV, with the wide viewing angles of the Q90, I'll be doing that instead. So those two definitely, and then some other stuff as well.
Yeah, the 82-inch, this is the first review that we're doing off-site, so this is a bit of an experiment.
For obvious reasons.
For obvious reasons, it's 82 inches. It's not going to get sent out for review. So Steve's going to spend the day with it, and it's going to be a first look, so there won't be any badges being awarded or anything.
A bit like my review of the N7.
Yeah, like the JVC review. But I think there's enough interest out there that it's worth us going. And we're going to use it as an experiment as well, because there's lots of big screens coming this year. And if you guys want to know what the 98-inch screen is like, it's going to require us going off-site, but we will try and cover them. In terms of what I'm doing this month, so we are doing something a bit different. We're going to test out a new way of doing the reviews that I do, and that is that we're going to move away from doing 8,000 word reviews.
Good.
And we're going to do video reviews, but wrapped around the text. So what you're going to see in the next couple of reviews anyway, and we'll see what your feedback is that you will get the what is the product, and it'll be a description of the product. You'll then get the video. So everything will be in the video, and then you'll get a written verdict and written pros and cons and any badges and that kind of thing. So the review will be maybe 1,000, 2,000 words, and you'll get a video. And the reason for that is I think everything's moving to video now. I think more people are interested in actually watching a video about a product. So we're gonna try it out and see what you guys think. So your feedback is wanted on this one. So the first product is going to be the Optoma UHL-55, which I reviewed in this podcast. It's the first video to go out in that format. We've then got a Marantz. We've got two Marantz AVRs, so 1509 and the 7013. Then the Yamaha 3080 AVR, and then a Vivatech 4K DLP projector. This 4K DLP is home cinema based, so a little bit different to the Optoma. So those are my reviews for the month ahead, and we're going to do them in this new format. There's also going to be a video about 2018 TVs and if it's still worth buying one now that we know what's coming in 2019. Other bargains out there, and I've had two long-termers, the Q9 and the C8, which will be in that review as well. My final verdicts on those as well. So that's all coming up this month from me. So it'll be interesting to get your feedback on that, on the new approach to certainly the reviews that I'm going to do for the site.
Just to be clear, I'll be retaining the people who need to read something on the toilet demographic. So that's where I know where my stuff is targeted. You'll still be able to enjoy my stuff on the throne, because
never write anything longer than the average dump.
Well, you see, this is complicated.
Well, anything, it takes longer to read than the average dump is what I mean.
Yeah, well, this is
not
the
length of the dump itself, obviously.
I know full well that you'll get to mid-morning at work and you think, do you know what? It's time to drop the kids off at the pool and just enjoy enjoy.
This is not how I wanted this conversation to go. I wanted this to be serious. Now, there's still going to be text review there. It's just, it's not going to be 8,000 words. And if you just watch the video, you're going to get everything in there. If you go and read the text and the video, you're going to get everything. It's choice at the end of the day, and it's, you'll still get the gist of it. It's not just going to be a video. So I just wanted to get that across. So it will be a shortened review in terms of length, in terms of wordage, but everything's there in the video or in the written site. So we're not completely stepping away from doing written reviews, but we want your feedback, because we want to basically do content that you guys are interested in reading or watching or so on. So let us know. So anyway, that's what's coming up this month, and that's our reviews done, and we'll be back with some movie reviews next. Okay, so movie reviews. I've actually been to the cinema this week and saw a film that I don't think anybody else has seen on the podcast. It was one that you mentioned last week, Steve, that I didn't even know was coming out. I hadn't seen any publicity for it, and actually I don't think it's had a very good promotional budget behind it, because it hasn't been that well.
I think the promotion has largely been around Stephen Merchant doing a lot of chat shows, as far as I can tell.
Yeah.
The clip where the Rock's having a go at them to show them how to be in character.
Yeah.
I've got to say, it's a very funny clip.
Yeah, never happened. It's based on a true story. That never happened.
Yeah, the story's true. The Rock was never actually involved in the real story.
Yeah.
He saw a documentary about it on TV in the UK and thought, ooh, that would make a great idea for a film.
Because he'd
worked on Tooth Fairy with Stephen Merchant. He rang him up and said, I think you should make this into a film. Stephen Merchant's like, but I don't know anything about wrestling. He goes, you don't need to know anything about wrestling. Yeah, I'll tell you what you need to know.
So, I've got you covered.
Well, I think he had him covered, yeah. I mean, yeah, it's The Rock. Yeah.
Well, I mean,
and The Rock has, I've got to say, in terms of promotion, that's been mostly it. Stephen Merchant on chat shows and The Rock all over social media, plugging it to death.
Yeah. No, I was just going to say, social media, I've seen quite a bit this week. Now that the
it's had really good through reviews as well, to be fair.
And I've got to say, I know nothing about the WWE or WWF, as it was when I grew up. Knew nothing about it. It never interested me whatsoever, because it's, I've always seen it as fake.
I mean, I grew up in the generation of English wrestling.
Oh yeah, I grew up with that as well. Big Daddy and all the rest of it.
The physique of a darts player. Yeah. You know, they were just big fat blokes with silly names like
Big
Daddy.
Fat professional athlete.
I remember
Kendo Nagasaki.
Yeah. As a kid, 3, 4, 5 year old, I used to get left from my granddad on a Saturday morning while my mum and granny and all the rest of it went out shopping for the day. And we used to sit and watch World of Sport in the afternoon. Was it World of Sport? The one
it
that Dickie...
World of Sport, yeah.
Yeah, used to sit and watch that. But anyway, getting sidetracked. I was never into WWF, WWE, knew nothing about Paige, who this movie's about. So I didn't have any anything going into this movie I didn't have any prior knowledge to. So I would imagine that anybody that actually knows the real story, a bit like Queen fans going to see Bohemian Rhapsody, anybody that has a vested interest in it or whatever, I get the feeling that a lot of the dramatic license has been used quite a lot on this. But I've got to say, it's an uplifting movie. The acting's pretty pish, actually, to start with. I found the acting to be quite wooden to start with, but then as the movie gets going, it actually improves. The humour is a lot of knob jokes in here. So, Steve, you'll like it. You know what a Steve Merchant film's going to be like, and I think that might play against it come an American audience, to be honest with you. It's very British humour, very British, very council estate humour. But obviously this is where this family are from. They're a council estate family, not a lot of money, but they loved wrestling. The whole family loved wrestling and were wrestlers. And the kids grew up, the brother's called Zach. The two kids went for trials. And only Paige gets through. I can't remember her name in the beginning of the film, but she becomes Paige anyway.
She has to change her name because of someone else in WWE has already got the same name, isn't there?
Yeah, something like that. But anyway, the brother doesn't get picked, and obviously there's the aftermath of that to deal with, is the fact that she is then shoved into a world that she doesn't know, and she's out on a limb and all the rest of it. It's a great feel-good movie. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I was thoroughly entertained. I hate wrestling. I can't stand it. I don't know anything about it. I thoroughly enjoyed this film. It's really well thought out. There's some really nice humour in there.
Is it the Billy Elliot of wrestling?
It reminded me of The Commitments.
Yeah,
that sort of level of feel good movie with some knob jokes and that kind of thing.
I will say Nick Frost looks massive.
He is. Yeah, he's very good, but he looks big. Then when you see the guy he's based on. Yeah, he's a bruiser, absolute big guy as well. So what it has done is it's given me an interest in going to see this documentary, the original documentary, because I want to know more about her, because it really is an interesting story. Now, not everybody's going to like it. Like I say, some of the acting is pretty terrible in it. There's a lot of unknowns in here as well. Obviously, it's made to a budget, but it's a feel-good movie. I felt good when I had a smile on my face when I came out of the cinema. And I didn't have my reviewer's hat on. I think if I did have, I'd probably be a bit more critical about it. But I wanted to go to the cinema. I wanted to lose myself for a couple of hours in a story and be interested and be entertained. And that's what I was. I was entertained. And it's a good feel-good movie. Is it a repeat viewing? Probably not. But, you know, it's a really competent at what it does, and it's given me an interest in finding out a bit more about the subject matter, which I had no interest in when I went in to see the film.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah,
you can't say fairer than that, can you? And not everything you go and see at the cinema has to be something you automatically go out and buy on a disc later.
No, absolutely.
So
there's only Steve does that.
I don't do that anymore. I didn't buy two Rock films last year.
Jesus. Yeah, but he cries himself to sleep every
night. But I am about to cream my pants at the thought of Hobbs and Shaw. So there you go.
Okay. Well, thank you for that beautiful message.
If you're still waiting on Captain Marvel coming this weekend, you want to go to the cinema, it's worth going to have a look at. If you want a feel good movie, have a bit of a laugh and so on. It's serviceable.
Landed a few body blows.
Yeah. I'm looking forward. Now, listen to this very carefully, people. This is not me. I'm looking forward to seeing Captain Marvel.
Well, most Marvel films...
Do you mean you don't want to see The Kindergarten Teacher or Miss Barlow or Everybody Knows or Border?
No.
On Friday.
Obviously, they're getting buried for some reason.
Those films clearly have no... They're not aimed at any particular... Yeah, Captain Marvel opens on Friday. I've got to say, the 90s setting is interesting. They seem to have done a pretty good job of de-aging Sam Jackson, basically. They stuck him in a wig. Yeah, he's got two eyes in it too, not an eye patch, so maybe he loses it during this film. And obviously, given that, not really a spoiler, but if you've seen the very, very end of Infinity War, when Nick Fury pages, he's got some sort of galactic pager, pages Captain Marvel. So I guess this is going to fill in some blanks there, and hopefully there'll be a teaser, a stinger at the end of the Captain Marvel that will lead us directly into the biggest film of this year, I think, by all
some
estimation.
Distance.
Yeah, by some distance.
Is that April? opening.
April, yes, the end of April.
Really? That's soon?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Basically, we've got 2 months and then we're into Endgame.
Christ, so... I have to actually go work out the time I'm going to go to the cinema. That's painful. Okay, fine. Good. Right. As you were.
But yeah, Captain Marvel. And obviously, because it's set in the 90s, there's a few characters coming back from Guardians of the Galaxy. So a couple of characters from Guardians of the Galaxy are in Captain Marvel, because it involves the war between the, was it, what are they called? The Skrill and the Kree. So, and those Kree characters in Guardians of the Galaxy. They've got Brie Larson as Captain Marvel. You've got Greg Wise. It's not Greg Wise. What's his name? What's his name?
I was about to say Greg Davis, but no, that's
no, not Greg Davis, not Greg Wise either.
Not Greg Proops, alas. So
the guy that plays hang on, let me just quickly look it up.
Oh my god, is
this people, this is what happens when you get old.
Yeah, exactly.
he's sailed past the 50 barrier and it's downhill all the way from here. I mean, I've now consumed an entire bottle of 7.5%.
Who plays Agent Coulson? I can't remember his name.
Oh no, this isn't gluten free.
Oh, Greg Clark. Sorry, that's yes. Greg Clark, who plays Agent Coulson. He's also in it because he dies in Avengers, but or doesn't die actually. He supposedly dies in Avengers and then gets better again for Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. the TV series. But yeah, he's in it too. So yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, I quite enjoyed the trailer. 3D. Yeah, yeah. I've got to say, I'm looking forward to that one. I was disappointed to learn that the 40th anniversary of Alien was shown at selected screens this last week. I only found out because Stuart told me about it the other day.
Yeah, I didn't know. Actually, I would love to have seen it on the big screen.
Yeah, I would have.
Because I was too young in 79 to get into the flicks for an 18. I noticed it's been downgraded to a 15. Actually, it was an X back in 79. But it's a 15 now, isn't it?
Yeah. The screening up here was sold out. By the time I'd gone through and tried to book a ticket, it was sold out. And it was only the only screening that's happening up here. So, yeah, a bit of a shame that, but I'd like to have seen it.
I wonder what it would have been like in the cinema in 79 when people didn't know what was going to happen to John Hurt.
Yeah.
Pants-shittingly terrifying. Let's not mince words here. I mean, especially as, let's not forget that cast reaction as well, because they didn't know. Everything about it, there's so many things about the first two Alien films that just the magic of seeing it once the first time can never be.
I did get to see Aliens in the cinema at, it was the Odeon in Marble Arch, and it was one of the few times, you know, where the audience was so into the movie. It was absolutely packed screening, and the film's brilliant. I absolutely loved it. But people were cheering and clapping, and it's just one of those rare cinema-going experiences where just the audience really play a part in making it one of the best.
But no, I've told you this before, but years ago, because the soundtrack for Aliens was mastered at Abbey Road, they did a series of showings of films that had their soundtracks done at Abbey Road, and Aliens is one of them. And I went along with a friend of mine, and it wasn't actually particularly state-of-the-art viewing experience, but we had the privilege of sitting in front of a lady who had never seen Aliens before. And when the scene with the facehugger in the tank came about, and I'm assuming he was immediately single after this, her boyfriend reached behind her, and at the point where it went at the tank, he just grabbed her other shoulder. And honestly, she essentially had to be pried out of the lighting room at the top of the room. It was just one of the most perfect moments because vicariously we all lived that moment again through her, especially because her boyfriend was being a monumental asshole. It's one of my favorite cinematic experiences of all time. It was absolutely peerless in all situations, but that just made it perfect.
Good stuff. So Captain Marvel is out on Friday this week. Right, moving on, discs released. These are coming out today if you're listening to the podcast on Monday. I'm a bit disappointed. I ordered my Bohemian Rhapsody from Amazon. I was expecting it on Friday and it hasn't turned up at all. I was going to watch it. But
not for Amazon, you don't. It was always Zavvi would be quite good at getting stuff to you at the weekend before it comes out. But generally with Amazon, I get it on the day of release. I got my copy and it's great because I think we mentioned this last week, didn't we? It's got the whole...
Live Aid,
recreated. Yeah. It's not. I mean, I don't know if the won four Oscars, most Oscar'd film of the year. apparently. I'm not sure about that. but I guess it won in categories mainly where it deserved it, like sound, yeah. sound editing. And,
the Oscars were strange this year. It was really mixed. Yeah, there wasn't one that stood out. Was also this week, Steve.
Deer Hunter. This is actually a reissue. So the Deer Hunter came out last year on 4K disc, but it was like a big sort of box set package with a soundtrack album and a booklet and this sort of stuff. This is just the re-release with just the 4K disc and the Blu-ray, rather than the big sort of expensive box set package. Looks great. Lovely 4K restoration. The photography in it is stunning. I still think it's an overrated film, but if you're a fan, you can get it on 4K disc for cheap, for less than the box set that came out last year. Also got, this is one I'm definitely going to get, Evil Dead 2 on 4K, one of the greatest sequels of all time. Or you could also say it's a remake of The Evil Dead, but it's so funny and so scary. It's one of those rare films that manages to do that, along with American Werewolf in London, does the thing of being both scary and funny at the same time. So that's definitely worth picking up if you're a fan. And also there's House of Cards Season 6, which is also on Netflix, but it's also now available on Blu-ray. This is the Frank Free version, when they... you know, they basically unceremoniously dumped Kevin Spacey for obvious reasons.
He died on his way back to his home planet, or whatever they did with that dog in The Simpsons. But yeah.
And there's also a film called The House That Jack Built, available on Blu-ray, but I don't know what that is.
I did briefly wonder if it was The Jack That House Built, which is an all-time great early house track from like 1980-something, but apparently yeah. not. So
okay. To wrap up this week, there's a new story that came out that I think we were expecting the BBC to do something in the current climate of streaming and all the rest of it. But it seems to be that themselves and ITV are going to get together for a streaming service to take on Netflix. What are they calling it again? Brit something?
BritBox.
Yeah.
Off to a flying start there.
It's seemingly rumoured to be $5.99 a month for this service, which has raised a few questions, which I gave the question to Andy Bassett, who is writing the news at the minute. Gave him a few pointers, gave him some guidance and said, go and do some research. A lot of people saying they want to do away with the licence fee. Are we going to get into this argument again? And he went away and he did a really nice piece on the whole thing, really well researched and all the rest of it. And basically the poll at the end of it was, should we keep the TV license? And there was a few questions. It wasn't as simple as that. It was, how do you think about the license fee? And one of the questions was, is the license fee the most appropriate way for the BBC to be funded? The next choice was, should the BBC change the way it's funded to remain relevant? Third one was, should the BBC become a commercial organisation and the licence fee scrapped? And then the fourth choice was other. So going through the poll, I wasn't surprised with the results, actually, because the third one, BBC commercial and scrapped the licence fee, had 50% of the vote. And then it was quite a drop back to the second one, which is to change the funding approach to make it more relevant. Only 17% thought that the current way of funding the BBC was the most appropriate. Obviously, these are AV Forums members. They have a slight slant, or obviously they're going to have a slight slant to the audiovisual side of things. But I went through the thread. The thread has had 380 replies. I knew it was going to be a good story, this one. And again, well done to Andy for putting it together. Yeah. But yeah,
the creation of a hot button topic right there. So but kudos. I did also think, yeah, it was very well written. Some of the replies are exactly as you'd expect. Others rather more nuanced. So well done to our membership for being variable in the extreme. But no, it's one of those things. I'm sort of inclined to agree that something has to change, but it's a bit of a knee-jerk reaction to go immediately all the way to you know, adverts and the rest of it. Only last week I was saying about the joys of their children's television channel being advertising free, and it would be a genuine shame to lose that sort of thing. But equally, I don't necessarily know. It's just little things. This has long been a hobby horse of mine. I don't know why their apps are free, because it's not part of any Rethian remit for them to sell to put smartphone apps and tablet apps out for bugger all. They should at the very least be revenue neutral. And the point where they stop, that where if an app makes enough money, it's paid for itself, it can subsidize apps that don't.
Yeah.
But that's all coming out of license fee.
Yeah, I think that's the answer. It should change its funding approach to remain relevant, isn't it, really?
Yeah,
I mean, absolutely. There's things it can do. There's stuff it's got. You've said before, Ed, it's sitting on a vast back catalogue of content that it could monetize, as I guess is ITV, although how they finance and produce their stuff, because they had different... ITV's made up of different companies, isn't it? Or used to be. And they had different production companies. So maybe it's not as easy for them. But the BBC definitely sits on a vast back catalogue of content that it could monetize. And I guess BritBox is one of the ways it's going to do it. But, I mean, people have been talking about, you know, it's going to need to produce new content to compete with Netflix. And then we're also going to have to look at how it delivers it in terms of, you know, things like HDR and 4K and Atmos and all the things that Netflix is already doing so well.
But you see, for me, and somebody brought it up in the thread, and I agreed with the point straight away, and that was, it's a public service. So basically the license fee is a tax for a public service.
It does things commercial channels would never do.
Right, so keep that. Keep that.
Want to keep that. I have absolutely no problem with the license fee.
But the problem is the entertainment side for me.
Yeah, where they're clearly like BBC America.
Yeah.
Stuff like that, where that's... But I mean, personally, I always find it amazing that people who will happily drop 100-odd quid a month on Sky moan about paying £100 a year for the BBC, when the quality of the content you get is vastly superior most of the time.
Yeah, I think what's put people's noses out of joint and why the question was asked was the fact that they're going to have to pay again to access content that should be free to them if they pay the license fee. I think that was people's initial argument with this BritBox thing. For me, and the comment that was raised was separate it out. So keep the stuff that the BBC should be doing, which is the educational stuff, which is the R&D, which is the stuff that other broadcasters don't do. But the entertainment side, where the huge wages are, and that's not just TV but radio as well, although, you know, why is the BBC doing that? Because there's so much competition out there. That already provide the same kind of thing. Why is the BBC doing that? Because the BBC's remit is not to compete with other broadcasters, but you get the feeling that that's what the mindset is these days, is it has to compete and be relevant. Well, actually, it's not in its remit to compete. One of the things in its remit is to entertain, but that's really quite a vague thing to have in there. I think if they separate out the entertainment side and keep the stuff that they do exceptionally well, like the educational stuff. So when I say educational, like educational and factual TV, the stuff that they do innovate on that other broadcasters don't do. And there should be an opt-in, an opt-out, and give people the choice of what they want to do. So the public service side of it, keep that. But they're going to have to look at the funding model going forward, would be my suggestion anyway.
The other thing that and I'm sure actually not going to anger a number of people listening to this, but it would be electoral poison, but it has to be done. I'm afraid that free licenses for large swathes of the elderly population probably have to come to an end. Mm-hmm. One, they are the primary consumers of a lot of the content. Two, the traditional situation where they were the least well-off in society has sort of been almost completely reversed in a number of cases. And ultimately, if you're targeting these people, I think it's the very least you can do to expect them to pay some money for what you're doing. But, you know, that's just me being a relatively fresh-faced 38-year-old. Yeah. I don't know if that's...
But it is interesting that 380... you know, comments on that story. So there is a strong feeling about it. So I don't know when it's up for renewal again. I don't know how relevant it is at the minute.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. We'll see how it goes. But
what happened to Steve? Is he here?
I'm here. Okay. I was just looking at some of the comments on the thread. I just found it quite amusing, the very first person. So I haven't watched any BBC channel in years. I only watched Netflix and Amazon Prime. So you're already paying more than the cost of the license fee a month just to do that. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I just think the BBC is great value for money, personally. But I agree that there is room for changes to the way it's funded. I think having a public broadcaster, I would pay the price of the license fee not to have to sit through adverts. Whenever I watch stuff on commercial channels, which is not that often, I don't ever watch ITV. I occasionally watch Channel 4, I've never watched Channel 5. But if I do watch something on a commercial channel, say like Last Leg or something like that on Channel 4, I will always record it and watch it later so I can get rid of the adverts. I won't sit through advert breaks for anyone. And frankly, I'm more than happy to pay a license fee to sit through three really good channels where I don't have to sit through advert breaks. I don't understand why people, we don't want to get like America. I mean, you've been to America, we've all been to the States and watched American TV. It's bloody awful. The amount of advert breaks they shove in. It just becomes intolerable.
I always wondered, with Friends and series like that, why they had that bit before the titles.
The cold opening.
Because that's so they can put more advertising in.
So they still have another advert break in. Yeah.
Yeah.
But in America, it would be cold open, credits, and then advert break straight away.
Or you get the advert before the credits.
Yeah, it's basically cold open, credits, and then advert break straight away. As soon as they can get one in, basically. I don't want to sit through that.
I don't want to do that.
I mean, it's okay on Netflix and Amazon Prime and stuff like that, because obviously there's no adverts there. Or if you're using Now TV as well, you avoid any adverts. So there's always ways around it. But I think the BBC does a lot of good stuff, but which people don't necessarily appreciate. Things behind the scenes, technological developments that are funded by them, because things that commercial channels just wouldn't be prepared to do because they wouldn't have the money to do it. A lot of the things we take for granted now in terms of broadcast technology were developed by the BBC or people like NHK, who again is a public broadcaster in Japan. So, we shouldn't just think about, the actual programming itself. You've got to look at the bigger picture. Yeah. But there are things they could be doing as well. I mean, like Ed said on previous podcasts, they're sitting on a goldmine of content that they could monetize.
We'll see how that goes. I'm prepared to, dragging this torturously back on topic, I'm prepared to give BritBox the benefit of the doubt. We'll see what happens. I mean, it comes, in the BBC case especially, it comes down to being able to release certain things that have been problematic to get agreements upon. I mean, the one that always springs to mind for me is Monkey Dust. Do you remember Monkey Dust? It was on the very first, I can't remember if it was even BBC Three back then. It was whatever, BBC I or something like that. That was the darkest of the dark. But thanks to the people that writing it having a massive disagreement, it's never been released again. If you could do as a launch title that was it, I could guarantee I could sit down and watch the episodes of Monkey Dust again. Yeah, they can have my £6. because it was seminal television. And then the early Michelin Web stuff that was on those things as well, which has very rarely seen the light of day. It just off the top of my head, the number of BBC things, and actually ITV does have some cracking stuff lying around in the arsenal. I've said this in the past. It comes under the heading of guilty pleasure viewing, but I am an enormous fan of that David Jason Touch of Frost thing. If I could just watch all of those as and when I wanted to, again, I'd be quite happy.
And they're not on constant loop on ITV3 and 4.
They're not. No, this. Where it gets complicated, because of the nature of their content and because they were shown over so long at different times, certain episodes appear in the middle of the day, done to death. Other episodes, you can go years and years and years without them being shown, which is really quite peculiar. And Steve, you'll know this because I don't doubt that you watched it the first time around. Do you remember that Richard Briers thing, If You See God, Tell Him?
Yeah.
Was that BBC or ITV?
I want to say BBC because it's Richard Briers, but I think it might be ITV.
I might have been on ITV. Again, I remember that being incredibly dark, but incredibly funny. And I would pay to watch that again and stuff like that. As a license fee payer and all the rest of it, the idea of paying more to do it again is disappointing. But I will give it the benefit of the doubt. And if, as you say, there's the ability to start perhaps mirroring content in higher resolutions, HDR, so on and so forth, yeah, well, it might yet fly. We'll see how it goes. I don't want to write it off. And then if we, just before we wrap up, are we about to wrap up? Is that what we're about to do?
Yeah, I was about to do that.
Right, just before we do, because I will have forgotten by the end of the month, and that's a terrible thing to do. This weekend just gone, Mark Hollis of Talk Talk, who was lead singer of Talk Talk, he died. Now, Mark Hollis is an interesting figure. There's loads written about him online, so I don't need to rehash it here. But essentially, he walked away from fame. He was done. He released, as part of Talk Talk, he released 5 albums. He then released a solo album, and he just went back to spend time with his family, and he very sadly passed to cancer this weekend. If you have never spent any time listening to Talk Talk, one, you're missing out, but two, if you are a Tidal subscriber, they have put together an absolutely fantastic biopic playlist of Talk Talk, which is just on their front page at the moment. If you were searching around for something to listen to, you could do an awful lot worse than that, because it charts one of the most unlikely progressions in music, from completely by the numbers neuromantic electric band to the inventors of post rock, and it does it effortlessly. It shows you the transition points they've done, and it takes you through what were some of the finest albums of their time. So if you haven't spent any time listening to the back catalogue of Talk Talk, it's a perfect introduction to one of the most important bands that there's ever been, and you can learn a little about one of the more interesting people who's been part of the British music scene in the last 40 years.
Okay, well, on that one, we will end the podcast for this week. My thanks to Steve Withers.
Rocks in our pockets and gravestones above our heads are all you're going to get from this podcast.
And Ed Selly.
We're your family now.
Don't forget, you can follow us on Twitter and Facebook, bookmark avforums.com for the latest reviews, news and videos. Plus, why not leave us a 5-star rating on iTunes, but only if you enjoyed the show. Also, head over and check out our YouTube channel for videos on the latest product launches and reviews, and feel free to subscribe while you are there. I'm Phil Hinton, thank you very much for listening, and we'll see you again next week.